Yo, can you guys hear me? Let's see. Hey, can you guys hear me? What's up, everybody? Sick, sick, sick. Awesome. Awesome. What's going on? Good morning. I'm really tired. Eyeliner on. Still. Yeah, good morning. Sick. I'm really excited to be here. I'm excited to talk about some of this stuff, man. You know, I get a lot of questions about branding and marketing almost every single day. So it'll be cool to kind of like dive into this a little deeper and sort of field some questions for you guys and give some direction on how to sort of navigate the EDM industry, how to navigate you know, using social media. And you know, giving yourself the most visibility when it comes to distributing your music online and doing it in a way where people are gonna see it, you know? So let's fucking get started, man. One second, real quick. Really quick. All right, that's better. All right, sweet. So, what I want to do first is real quick, if you're in the chat, write down some questions, write down some things that you want to ask me, where we can kind of take this talk, and I'll sort of kind of go from there to give you guys some tips, some tricks on branding and marketing, you know? So, if you want to do that right now, hit the chat, ask me some things that you'd like to know. You can ask some personal things with my brand and we can get this thing going, you know? And first and foremost, it's good to be here and shout out Barong family and shout out everybody who's you know, listening. How do I get from the bedroom to the stage? Cool. Well, so what I'm gonna do right now is I'm also gonna pull up my artist manifesto, which is on my Instagram, if you'd like to view it. And we'll kind of go from there. Okay, these are good questions. I love this. I love this. Cool. All right, perfect. How do I get from the bedroom to the stage? How do I build your fan base? Do you think having a clearly pronounced name is important? What is the best social media platform? Yo, man, what's up? You give you the biggest, how do you get the biggest engagement? How much time do you spend per day on socials in order to lose? How do you start rebranding? All right. So these are all like really, really, really good questions. And so what I want to do first and foremost is you know, I'm gonna get to all these questions, but I kind of wanted to get an idea where we can take this talk. And sort of, you know, help you guys do the best. So first and so I am expanding the merch collection for sure. So first and foremost, what I think is most important when it comes to you know, doing music and all that stuff is you need to work hard one day at a time. So, you know, thinking about really long range goals is good, but what's most important is doing what you can one thing today. You know, just take it one day at a time. So it's like, what can I do today to take a step forward? Because ultimately, all of those steps are going to add up into something much bigger, you know, and much better. It's really, really, really important to set specific goals. People who I know are who are very successful and achieve their dreams, these really big dreams. They don't think about it like, okay, hey, I'm going to be a famous DJ, you know, I'm going to play EDC every year for 5 years. You know what I mean? They don't think like that. The way that people think who are successful, they think in small goals, very small goals. So, you know, first it's, I want to play my first show at this venue at this time. I want to release one song on Barong Family. I want to be on Family Matters volume, whatever they're on now, you know. I want to put out an EP on Barong Family before the end of the year, you know. So it's very specific, you know. So for me, some of my most recent goals that I made on my vision board, these are all of my goals right here. Okay, guys, all of my goals, tons of different things that I want to do. And so my first big goal this year was play Masters of Hardcore 25th anniversary, which was supposed to be last weekend, but obviously coronavirus. So yeah, but it was very, very specific, you know, and I was like, I want to play on the extreme hardcore stage. So by setting very specific goals, it gives you something to work towards, you know, small things to be working towards, small achievements that will ultimately add up to bigger and larger things, like being a famous DJ or some shit like that, or being able to quit my day job. You know, I want to save $2,000, you know, in 4 months. So these really big, lofty goals are great. And obviously that's the end game. But what needs to happen initially is very small steps, but those steps need to be very, very specific. And that's a really, really good starting point when it comes to growth, when it comes to sort of getting the path right. Because aimlessly going through things, figuring out things is part of a process, but that's not how we really can harness, harness our strengths and harness our creativity and build it into something even larger, you know? Because for so many years, I really didn't have any clear direction, you know? And I want to preface the rest of this with, this is just from my experience, okay? I can tell you what it's been like for the past year and a half-ish, about a year and a half, maybe a year and 7 months, going from not having a music career, being completely lost musically, thinking about quitting music, and then completely basically rebranding into something that I wasn't prior, and having a ton of success with it, at least in my eyes. I mean, what I can tell you is I was able to quit my day job, and I'm a full-time DJ now. And, you know, that was my dream, you know? So I can kind of give you a play-by-play of how that happened for me. So anyways, small goals. That's the start. Figure out what you want to do and start taking those small steps to get there, you know? And obviously have big ones, you know? Obviously have goals that are really big. But the small ones on the way are how we're going to do that. The next thing I want to say is, when it comes to branding, social media, and marketing, things need to be organic to you. Okay, I see lots of people try to force a brand. They try to force content. They see a one DJ do something, so they try to do it, you know, in their own way. And a lot of the times it's not gonna hit, because what's the reality of the internet age is that people can see when something's fake. They can see when somebody is trying too hard, you know? They see right through it. They say, oh, this is what's his name trying to do, this other guy, or, you know, this is what, you know, just inorganic, you know? It's so try hard, you know? So when it comes to starting to build a brand and to start building an image and start putting out content around that image, it needs to be something that's very true to you. Like I'm from Texas, you know. I love hardcore. And those two things in themselves don't necessarily go together. In fact, a lot of people are like, what the fuck? Like a cowboy making hardcore? Like this doesn't make any sense. And he's from America. This is a very popular genre in Europe, and other places, but wasn't very represented in America, at least in the modern days. You know, obviously there's Rob G, Omar Santana, Lenny D, you know, Delta 9, all these guys from the 90s, and those guys are still doing stuff, especially Rob, I love you. But bringing extreme hardcore, especially up-tempo hardcore, into the American EDM market was something that hadn't been done in a while. And so when we decided to start releasing the 200 BPM stuff, we looked at our market and we decided, okay, well, look, we need to be able to pitch this music to the market that we're in. Okay. So, and worry about the other markets later because I'm an American, you know, and I'm going to be playing shows primarily in America. I'm trying to play EDC. I'm trying to play Insomniac events. I'm trying to play other big festivals like Freaky Deaky, festivals in the Midwest, East Coast, EDC Orlando, blah, blah, blah. You know, it goes on and on. But I need to appeal to the American EDM market because trying to appeal to a small market is already shooting myself in the foot. You know, I want the world. But primarily, I needed that Insomniac EDC, you know, that section to like me, you know, and to be able to get on a base stage. Because if I can't do that, then I'm probably not going to play shows, you know, and I'm probably not going to ultimately start going to Europe and start going to other countries, to in Australia, et cetera, to do what I do. And ultimately, I want to be able to headline and sell tickets, you know. So I said, okay, cool. So I said, all right, cool. So we've got this really extreme music, you know, 200 BPM plus. People telling me that it'll never work. You won't be able to like get off of a hard style stage. You won't be able to sell your own tickets. Like this is too fast. It's too extreme, literally, you know. And we were like, no, fuck that. We can do this. I know how to do this. I know how to actually take this and pitch it to an EDM market. So for all intents and purposes, I didn't brand myself as a hardcore DJ. If you look at traditional hardcore branding, I don't necessarily fit that. I have my own style and my own way that I, you know, kind of embraced to give my music the most visibility. And that's what this talk is going to be about. You know, I'm going to start getting into that stuff right now, the actual details of posting and content. But I wanted to preface it with all this, you know, this little talk about it because we need visibility. We need the most people to like our shit, you know. We want them to share what we have, you know. So a lot of people fight social media. A lot of people fight branding. They fight the idea of marketing. Oh, music should speak for itself. And I love that. You know, the music does need to be there. But there are so many good producers in the game. The amount of kids that send me incredible music every single day is crazy. It's honestly mind-blowing. But the difference between somebody who's successful and have fans and people listen to their music is they usually have a brand and some good marketing, you know, and they're being pushed ultimately by a label, but they always start on their own, you know, by and large, they start on their own. And that's the beautiful thing about the day and age of 2020 is that you have a ton of free resources, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, Twitch, You know, we have free resources at our fingertips. All we have to do is make the content to distribute through those places, you know? Because I had, let's see, a year and a half ago, I had 8,000 followers on Instagram, and I have 35,200 now, which isn't crazy, you know what I mean? But to gain almost 30,000 followers in a year and a half on Instagram, completely organic, I 100% attribute that to the content and the music to go along with that content. Okay. So that's very important. Okay. What I want is for everybody to leave this talk with some inspiration and some knowledge and the drive to make content and branding part of their creative process. Okay. So obviously write music. The music is first, you know, and the music will tell you what to do. You know, you finish a song, you listen to it and you go, okay, cool. Let's talk about art. Let's see what we want to do for a single. Okay. So how else can we promote this? Okay. Like maybe let's get some motion content going for the day of the release. Let's make a funny video. Let's, you know, do all these different things when it comes to releasing music to give it more visibility. Because what happened was I was making these funny videos and people were sharing them. David, I love you. People were sharing them all over the internet, you know? And then I started seeing people copy me. but that started getting people to like my music. It was like, well, hey, I don't like hard style. I don't like hardcore. But wait, let me watch this funny video. Wait, this is, and then they go, wait, this is kind of funny. This is cool. Wait, let me go look at Lil Texas's music. And they go, wait, maybe I do like hard style. Maybe I do like hardcore, you know? And so if they come into my music that way through humor, or they come into my music via a funny post, then that's great, you know? Whatever gets them started, I don't care. I don't really care. But I want you to listen to music, and I want you to listen to hardcore, because hardcore is fucking awesome. It is sick as fuck. It's fast. It's brutal. It's rough. It's raw. It's awesome. You know, and so whatever gets you into that, then fucking awesome, you know, fucking awesome. So now what I want to talk a little bit about what that looks like, because it just, we got to call a spade here. You know what I mean? We got to get rid of the idea that social media doesn't matter, that, a lot of people say, oh, I wish this shit didn't matter. You know, I wish it was, you know, it's just a brand. It's just marketing. Fuck that. Get that out of your fucking head, you know, for real, because it does matter. And it's the way that you will gain fans, get big DJs to like your music, and ultimately play more shows, make money, get to travel, you know, all of that. Let's Mario. Cool comment. I like that. So we get that out of our heads. You know, you get over it, because a lot of people resist it. They don't want to take that effort. They don't want to have to do it because it's hard for them. And it kind of comes a little naturally to me. But we have to get rid of that idea. Okay, get rid of the idea that social media branding and marketing doesn't matter. And once you come to that piece of it, and you say, okay, this is the modern age of releasing music. I'm in my bedroom. I don't have a lot of money, you know, but I can get a cool, decent cover art from an artist, and I can make a little video like on my phone. And I do have some tools to promote, you know, because that's what it is. It's like, dude, all of these DJs you see, they started with no followers. You know, they started with 300 followers. They started with 400 followers, put out music and put out videos, and eventually something caught, you know, and they followed that up with rapid succession to continue that growth. Okay. So I'm going to give you guys some of my fundamentals. This is important. Okay. So If you want to look at this, this is on my Instagram, okay? It's called the Little Texas Artist Manifesto. This is very, very, very important stuff, okay? Here's some key things with branding, guys, all right? Embrace bizarre juxtapositions, right? Dress with high visibility clothing. People should know it's you when you walk into a room, all right? Learn the tradition, culture, and history of your particular music, and then forget all of it. Be actively engaged with your fan base. The audience is more important than you. I am so big on this. Manifest the intangible into something tangible within the digital market. Occupy time with your art during people's lives. When releasing something new, treat it like a product. Give the user multiple layers of engagement. Be a good human and practice self-care. The entertainment and art industry can be toxic. Take care of your body and your mind will be more sound. Create a world around your art, bring other interests into the narrative, and establish unique keywords, slogans, and images directly related to your product for the association factor, okay? So that last one, yellow motherfucking claw, you know, it's their slogan, you know, fuck Little Texas. It's the slogan, you know, so you start having keywords, 200 BPM, it's God's tempo, you know, you start building these keywords that go along with your brand. Now, the first thing that I mentioned was embrace bizarre juxtapositions, okay? So if, for anybody out there who doesn't know what the word juxtaposition means, it means when you take two things side by side that are different, they're opposites, okay? They don't make sense together, right? But if they're organic to the individual, because it's like, okay, I love listening to pop music, but I also love listening to metal and grindcore and hardcore, okay? So it's like both of those things are things that I like, you know, but right up next to each other, Taylor Swift and Cannibal Corpse, that doesn't make sense. You know what I mean? That's an extreme example. But for me, it was hardcore, and being a cowboy, it was you know, using old school sounds but modern kicks, you know, blending, you know, so many dubstep and hard style, you know what I'm saying? Blending trap and hardcore. You know, that's a really good starting point for developing a brand, is to embrace something that doesn't make sense. But if those two things that don't make sense are natural to you, people will feel it. People will go, hey, that's weird, but it makes sense. Because when you look at me, you don't go, oh, this is weird. Like, I mean, maybe you do, but to me personally, I believe this, that people see this and they go, oh yeah, that's him. They're like, oh yeah, he's just a fucking tatted up, you know, cowboy who loves hardcore, you know? And that's how we started. We said, okay, let's start mashing things together that don't make sense, you know, but they do. If they're pitched right, also they do, you know? So start there. Start thinking about things that don't work together, you know? So I mix a lot of like Western fashion with like punk fashion, and I mix a lot of metal stuff with hardcore shit, you know? I personally really like clothes, and so I'm always kind of like looking at what's trending in fashion and then bringing those sort of things that are popular at the moment and peppering them in with like my normal cowboy, you know, hardcore shit, you know, because it works. So you find that out for yourself, man. You find out what works for you, and you start blending that. You know, when Yellow Claw started making trap, I mean, dude, like people in Holland and were like, what the fuck, you know? But it worked, because they liked it, you know, and then it migrated over to America. It's like they took something that started arguably in the States as an underground electronic genre and brought it over to a place where it wasn't necessarily like super popular at the time. You know, Carnage playing Hardstyle is another good example where it's like he releases so much rap music, you know, and he has like songs that are hits, but this dude is playing Hardstyle at a fucking big ass show while playing like rap bangers, you know. It's him. He loves Hardstyle and he loves rap. So, and I know him personally, and I know this, that's true. And so it works for him because he believes it, you know, and he loves it. And that's what when I say you got to be organic and you have to do what's natural to you and authentic to you, because when you don't do that, it doesn't work. And I've seen people do it and it feels like this forced brand. And you know what's the reality? People are not dumb on the internet. People are actually really smart on the internet. And fans can see right through the bullshit. They can totally see when you're trying too hard, you know? And look, you try hard because you care, you know? But there's a fine line, you know? Exactly. The public will see through fake branding marketing. Absolutely, absolutely. So yeah, the next thing I want to talk about is being highly visible. You know, for me, being a loud personality and fashion and clothes and my look and my, you know, I'm fucking tatted the fuck up. That stuff, I do it because I like it, but also because I want people to know it's me, man. I want people to remember me. You know, so when you see me up on the stage, whether you like hardcore or not, you're going to remember who the fuck I am, you know? You're going to remember that DJ set because he played 600 BPM at the end of his fucking set, you know? And when I walk into a room, people see the hat and they go, oh shit, that's him. They see the neck tattoo and they go, oh shit, that's him. I'm not saying go get a neck tattoo, you know, I'm not saying wear a fucking hat, but there's ways to brand that or wear a mask or whatever. But you can start doing things that people are going to start recognizing you, like really embracing one color. You know, it's like my friend Mad Girl, she only does purple. That's her thing. She's everything's purple, you know. And you know, I really associate the colors yellow and black with Barong family and Yellow Claw, especially, you know, yellow and black. Valentino has the mustache. Funtcase has the mask. You know, Funtcase's mask is so iconic. You know, you see that mask and you go, oh, fuck yeah. You know, Funtcase, here we go. Al Ross, he's a total fucking freak show. You know, dubstep guy, total fucking weirdo. But you know, it's him. Sudden Death has a very unique look, you know. You can always tell it's him and he wears the headband, you know. So think about those things for yourself, because being highly visible, being somebody that people look at and they go, oh, he's cool. Like, I like that. You know, I want to be a cool artist, you know, is good, you know, because I want to influence people with my clothing and I want to influence people with my look too. You know, because when I was a kid, I used to really like punk, you know, and so I'm looking at these dudes with mohawks, fucking studs on their fucking jackets, like tatted up, you know, and I thought that shit was cool, man. I was like, damn, that's really fucking cool. You know, this dude has a sick mohawk or he has Liberty spikes, his hair is green. And I really, really liked that personally. So for me, and I believe this, that if you got a little bit of a brand physically, you know, that's going to start working. You know, wear the same thing, you know, wear tracksuits or whatever, you know, like nonsense. They wear tracksuits. Moxie, they wear tracksuits when they DJ. You know, I always wear a cowboy hat, you know. You can recognize me with my face tattoo or my neck tattoo and stuff. You know, my tattoos mean thing. You know, they have meaning. Like, I got 200 BPM tatted on me. You know what I mean? These tattoos are more than just, you know, whatever. They're my brand iconography because I'm dedicated to this shit. I did not say the N-word. Anyways, learn the tradition and culture of your music, okay? So for me, you know, understanding where hardcore comes from and the artists who invented that, you know, and pioneered that genre in America and in Holland, obviously in Holland, where it comes from. Anyways, those guys are the people who I, you know, look up to and understand how they started it. But I don't necessarily need to be like them. I also need to be aware of what's happening in my specific genre or whatever genres, you know, but also, also sort of forget all of that at the same time, if you know what I'm saying. So be aware of what guys are doing, understand new, production techniques, maybe learn them, but copying people, creating a bass just like whoever, doesn't fucking help you because it's already been done, you know? So maybe learn the technique, maybe learn these things, be aware of what your fellow DJs and producers are doing, but never copy them, ever, I think. You know, maybe learn to make it, what's the point? What's the point of releasing a song with the same lead as somebody else? Just because it's cool. What's the point of making a bass just like Sudden Death? Exactly like Sudden Death. You know what I mean? Or somebody. Because it's popular. That's no way to stand out. You know, that's absolutely no way to stand out. You know, so creating your own bass that might be different, that you go, oh, that's really weird. That's the bass that you should use. The song that you think is too weird is the song that you need to release. Not the song that you think is gonna do well because it's fits in a category or it's a banger, you know what I mean? Because you know how many fucking bangers there are out there? Millions, fucking millions of bangers. And they all sound the same. And that's the problem, because all it takes is one big hit, you know? So everybody's trying to make the one big hit, but everybody ends up ultimately sounding the same. And then you got a guy who, like me or somebody, who comes out and is like 200 BPM. And people go, what the fuck? And then I, all of a sudden, you know, a year later, people are like, hardcore, fuck yeah, you know, in America and all that. And they thought it was too weird. It was too fast. It wasn't going to work. And the reality is it did work because it was different. Because it was something that a lot of people, not everywhere, but a lot of people hadn't heard, you know, especially in the American EDM market. So be aware, but also don't fucking worry about it. Just fucking write. And the weird shit is the good shit, in my opinion. That those tracks that are different, the weird track is the song that you need to put out. Okay. Hey, MOD forever, my man. Respect. So, you know, and obviously be actively engaged with your fan base. I respond to like every DM mostly, unless it's really weird. And most every tweet I at least favorite, you know? So I'm very actively engaged with my fan base because we're one system, you know what I mean? Like, dude, we're a hardcore movement. All of us, you know, maybe I'm making the music and maybe I'm putting out the content, but we're all in it together, man. Like, this isn't just me. This isn't about me. You know, this is about hardcore and the troops, you know what I mean? And other hardcore people, you know, who love it. And that's the thing that's more important than my own success, is the genre of hardcore and the music, you know? And it's cool. I end up, you know, talking to cool people and it really makes a lot of people's day because I like it when a DJ responds to me, you know, when I hit up, you know, a DJ, that maybe is not following me and they end up seeing my DM and they're like, oh, what's up, dude? They like follow me or whatever. Or we start chatting. Maybe they don't follow me, but that's fucking awesome. And I love that, you know, and it's very important. Dude, very important, because over time I see DJs who don't interact with their fan base lose some steam, you know, especially within EDM, you know, especially within EDM. This one is important. Okay. I want to talk about taking up people's time. All right. Because what we have now in the digital age, people don't buy CDs. We don't have physical copies of our music anymore. It's streaming. It's all on my phone. Everything is here. Okay? And it's very quick and disposable. On what is my opinion on big fans, since we're talking about fans? I love them, you know? I love them. It's great. Everything is disposable. Everything is on the phone. So you got to think about time. How much time are you taking up in people's lives? And are you giving them a reason to take up their time? You know what I mean? Like, are you putting out something interesting enough for somebody to give you 2 minutes of their day, to give you an hour of their day, to give you a like, to give you a reshare? Like, is it really worth it for them? And you got to think like that. Because that's the age that we live in. This is the digital age. You know, it takes 2 seconds to go and you're done, you know, and you're up the feed. Nobody cares, you know, nobody likes it. And then the algorithm's fucked and you're screwed. You know, nobody ends up liking your post. So time is now the CD. You know, people don't go buy the CD. They give you time, you know? So how much time are you taking up in a fan's life? How much time are you taking up in a user, you know, cause we're music is a product, live. So I put out a DJ mix and somebody listens to the whole thing. That's an hour of their day they just spent with me. You know, somebody watches my live stream. That's another hour of their day spent with me. They like a tweet. That's like 10 seconds at the most. They read it and like it and reshare it 10 seconds. They listen to a single, 3 minutes. They share it, maybe an extra 30 seconds, you know. They watch your story on Instagram. They watch the whole thing and they don't skip through. You know, there you go. Maybe that's an extra 45 seconds to a minute. And that's, you know, that's what we have as artists. So make something that has value, like Chef Ray David said, because value will give people something to look forward to and something to share and something to actually care about, you know? So we have time. Time is the physical thing has become the physical thing. Okay. So how much time are people giving you daily? And are you giving them something that's worth it, worth giving up their time? There's a lot of content out there, guys, a lot of content. And so when you're releasing things, it's like I said, it's a product, you know what I mean? It's not just a song. It's a product. It's a whole thing. So for me, it's art. It's a video. It's, you know, more than just a song. There's maybe a concept behind the song, you know, maybe a music video. You know, so when you start thinking about it that way, it's easier to start thinking about content and direction. And guys, I'm going to get to some of these questions here in about a couple minutes. Okay. Give me a couple minutes. I'm almost done with this sort of talk. Self-care is really important too. I know this is like a side note, but like, be healthy. Don't get fucking wrapped up in the party scene, man. Don't, you know, guys move to LA and they start doing a shitload of blow and they start drinking every single night and they go to Space Yacht every fucking Tuesday. Shout out Space Yacht. But you know, they just fucking party and they think that they're networking. That's not networking. Doing cocaine and drinking until 5 a.m. is not networking. It's making fake plans. I've never seen anything happen like that. All of the big deals and connections and stuff that I've gotten have been from the fucking internet, man. CKMA. I've been from the internet, man, and have not been from doing blow till and partying, not even doing blow, but you know, partying until 4 a.m, man. Like, that shit ain't real, dude. It's just people running their mouths. So, yeah, we should do this, we should do that. Yeah, you might meet some DJs, you might get some FaceTime, and it's good to go out, but that's not where the real shit happens, man. The real shit happens in front of your computer making music and you know, putting out content. The focus is music and content. That's your focus as an artist. And the last thing I want to talk about before I kind of start fielding some of these questions is, the overpass. Thank you, David. but anyways, yeah, if you want to party, go ahead and party. Like, I'm not judging you at all. Like, we love to party, but be careful. That's all I'm saying. It's just be careful. Yellow Claw just DM'd me. That's how I met Barong Family. They just sent me a DM one day. So the last thing I want to talk about is building a world around your art and your brand. It's not just about music, man. Like I'm a human. And for me, I'm not a brand. So you've got a brand like, let's say Gravedigger, for example, okay? Gravedigger's ominous. You don't know who he is. You know, he's and that works for him because it's cool and that's what he does, you know? But that's not me. I'm very out there. I'm very loud and I want you guys to know about me, you know what I mean? And know what I'm into, because building a world around the art makes you more relatable. If you catch what I'm saying. So it's like, oh, Lil Texas really likes the band Korn, you know, and like he talks about that. And so I'm really influenced by that band. And so I start bringing stuff in from Korn into my content and in my tweets and stuff. And like System of a Down and things like that. And it's like, oh, a lot of other people like that. And they go, oh, wow, we have similar interests. You know, oh, Lil Texas likes techno too. Wow, I really like techno. And so then you start getting these techno heads into hardcore, and you start getting these hardcore heads into techno, you know? Lil Texas is really into like tattoo culture. Okay, sweet. Like there's another layer of that. I like to cook, and I'm sure some of you guys are watching, you know that I cook, and I have like a little Instagram page. And so I promote that too. And they go, oh, wow, he's at home cooking when he's not making hardcore. You know, it's all those different things. Oh, I'm like, you know, showing you what I'm doing in my daily life. Like, hey, me and my friends are taking pictures, you know, me and my, you know, I'm showing you how I make content. You know, I'm not keeping things hidden, that hidden, you know. I got this necklace from a girl, actually. She left it at my house. And then I stole it, but she gave it to me. She saw me wearing it. I took it. And then I saw her at the club like a week later, and she was like, hey, it's my fucking necklace, asshole. And I was like, oh my God, I'm so sorry. She was like, it's okay. It looks great on you. You can keep the necklace. So yeah. Anyways. So bring other parts of your life into your brand, man. You know, I like to show people how I make kicks. I like to do things like this and basically give away my secrets, you know? And that's really like it, you know. There's a framework that I just gave you guys. Okay. And what I really highly suggest is going and looking at my artist manifesto. Okay. Right here. It's on my Instagram. Maybe I'll post it again on Facebook or something today, but go look at it. Go check it out, because everything I've talked about today is right here. Okay. And it's a great guideline, okay? And again, all I can tell you guys is the guideline. I can't tell you how to make your own brand. You know, I can be like, oh, yeah, wear a mask, or, oh, yeah, get some tattoos, or only wear blue, or, you know, I can say things like that. But that ultimately, it's going to be up to you guys. You know, you guys got to start taking the action. So make branding and marketing part of your creative process. Work at it, get better at it, learn how to make better art, learn how to make better content. Learn how to take funny memes and culture, internet culture, and warp it into your brand, you know? Like I made a meme that was like the girl like opening her eyes and seeing like her new car, but it was Yellow Claw, Radical, and me. It's one of my most recent posts. So I saw this meme and I just put me, Radical, and Yellow Claw, and I used that to promote the track. Instead of being like, hey, new track, fucking new collab in 3 days. Like, make sure you save it, dude. You know what I mean? Like, why? I made a meme of me radical and Yellow Claw, and it got great engagement because people really liked it. They thought it was funny. You know what I mean? And humor is a great way. Here's the meme. You know? So I used this to promote the track. My collab with Kazo, I didn't even do anything. I released my Kazo collab with a meme. So if you go on my Instagram, you'll be able to see this shit. I literally just posted a meme and I was like, Kazo collab out today. And it got way better engagement because it was funny. And people were like, oh my God, that's great. And it looked different instead of just like putting out the art moving. You know what I mean? Like, that's boring, dude. I don't ever do that. You'll never see me do that ever. Like maybe for a preview, maybe for like, hey, here's a little sneak preview. So be organic, find out some things that work for you, and be an artist. We're in the entertainment industry, guys. I think a lot of DJs and producers forget that. They forget that we are entertainers. You know, DJs get up on stage and are boring as fuck and just sit there and mix. That's boring, dude. I don't want to fucking see that. Give me a show, man. I want to be entertained, bro. You know? So that's what this is about. It's about being an artist. It's that the culture of EDM and producing is so like bedroom producer culture. It's like, it's very rare when you see an artist emerge, you know, and you see somebody who's otherworldly or has a big presence and has a really cool look and embodies this like rock star. For me, it's like this rock star lifestyle shit. You know what I mean? It's like, I don't want to be an EDM star. I want to be a fucking rock star, man. You know, and travel the world and do cool shit. So yeah, all of this shit is really important. So now I'm gonna start answering some questions. Okay, were you guys with me? Was this helpful? Did you guys find this this lecture to be very informative? So the moral of the story is tattoo your neck. Post shirtless pics and you'll be a famous DJ. No, I'm kidding. Yeah, so there's an outline, you know. There is a method to the madness. There's a science behind social media and stuff, but it has to come from you, not me. I can't tell you what your brand is going to be. All right, let's see. Let's grab. I'm gonna just try to answer some of these randomly, okay, guys. No plans on coming to Portugal soon, unfortunately. How do I get from the bedroom to the stage? Good question. Exactly with everything that I talked to you about here. You need to build fans. You need to grow on the internet, and then you'll get enough hype. The people will start saying, "Hey, that guy. Oh my God, he's coming to town. Holy shit." And you'll get like a little small festival booking or something, you know? But it starts online, man, because we're all in our bedroom. This is not my professional studio. This is where my bedroom. So you start there, man. You start online, dude. And you give yourself visibility and you establish a brand online, and that will carry over into the stage. And that's how you build a fan base as well, Cash Cherry. I think having a clearly pronounced name is important. I think having a name that you can Google is really important. You know, you can have a weird name. Sometimes that works if it's like kind of like, how do you say it, you know? But I would be careful with that. I would. Make sure you can Google that shit. Because ultimately you're going to be pissed off if you can't. But at the same time, like, really big keywords are really good too, you know? You know, maybe changing one letter is also good, you know? But things that are like, you know, like sudden death, you know what I mean? It's like sudden death. Like, he died of a sudden death, you know what I mean? Like, that's a very, like, common phrase. But he changed that one letter and it really worked for him. The best social media platform for putting out music? I mean, dude, they're all important, man. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram are my three big ones, you know. SoundCloud, I guess, is a social media platform as well. It's not dead. I release mixes on SoundCloud and they do great. Twitter is great in America. A lot of American EDM fans on Twitter, but not so much the rest of the world. Facebook, really big in the rest of the world, not so big in America, at least in my experience. Instagram is pretty big everywhere, so Instagram should definitely be a big focus. But I focus on all three of those equally, actually. And if you're an American, do not fucking sleep on Facebook and do not sleep on Twitter, for real. Very important. Very important. Twitter separates the men from the boys. What gave you the biggest gain in engagement? How much time do you spend on day per socials? This is a good question. Pay attention right now. This is fucking important as fuck. I should have talked about this earlier. God, this is so important right now. So if you're watching, don't fucking forget this. You don't need to post every day. Let me repeat that. You don't need to post every day. I'm being fucking serious. You want to see your engagement fall? You want to see your engagement drive down? Post every single fucking day three times. Don't do it. Get good content and post it every other day or every 2-3 days. Sometimes I post every day. I'll go 3 or 4 days where I post every day and then I stop. I take a break, 1 or 2 days off. Because why? Why post something that's mediocre when you have something good that you can think about it and like come up with a good concept and come out with something in 2 days from now? And then you have 2 fucking days to figure it out. You know, instead of being like, oh, I got to post today. Oh, shit. I got to post on social media today. It's like, do you? Like, just wait till tomorrow. You know what I mean? You got to post. I'm not saying wait like a week. Like, I'm not saying don't post for a week. I'm saying if you have to wait 3 days, that's totally okay. Because good content that's going to get good engagement is better than 2 mediocre posts that get mediocre engagement. Just to post. Why? Why would you do that? Don't tweet random bullshit all the time. Come up with good tweets. Yeah, okay, like Twitter's good for posting random thoughts, but like think and do that. But think about what you're posting and wait if it's not applicable. Seriously, that's how you grow. That's how you grow. And that's actually how you will get more engagement. But if you want to see your engagement fall, post a bunch of bullshit every fucking day. Post the same picture, but different clothes every fucking day. You know what I mean? Post the same cool DJ photo, like you up against it, like a fucking staircase or some shit every other day. Sometimes that's good. Post like that sometimes, but not every fucking day. Cause dude, and it's like, if you do a photo shoot and you post like 5 pictures from the same photo shoot, like dude, watch your engagement just dive, dude. I post 1 photo, maybe 2 from every photo shoot I do. 1 photo. That's it. And so I spend a lot of time on social media, as you can tell. Start rebranding. All right, here's a good question. Rebranding. I've been there. Don't make it a fucking announcement. I fucking hate that shit. Oh, I'm just going to do something more me now. Oh, I really, you know, I don't feel this music that I was making anymore. Like, here's my new direction. Like, this is so much more true to me. Like, just fucking do it, dude. That's what I did. I didn't say anything. I went quiet for 8 months. And then I was like, hardcore, textcore, 200 BPM. And I just did it. I didn't, like, talk about it. You know, I kind of alluded to it. Be like, this is the new sound. You know, I said stuff like that. Like, this is the new sound. Like, welcome to the future of Lil Texas. You know, think sort of like that. But I never was like made some sappy fucking post about how I'm not happy with my brand and I'm gonna do something different. You know, like maybe I'll do something like that eventually. But I never like it when people do that. Again, these are my opinions. So just fucking do it, bro. Just fucking do it. Nice comment. Sexo-anal. Good comment. Yeah. How did you decide to take the avenue of 200 BPM and make it your own? I used to listen to your stuff before. Nice. and it was so hip hop oriented and jazzy. Do you still dabble in jazz and hip hop? Yeah, I still like that stuff, man. But you know what the reality was? The reason why I stopped making the music I was making before was because it did nothing for my career, and I was beating a dead horse. I was doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results. And that's just fucking crazy. You know, I tried and tried and tried and tried for like years. I'm not saying like if your track doesn't pop off, switch genres. You know what I mean? Maybe give it some time. But if you're doing the same thing for 6-7 fucking years, man, like, it's tough, dude. It's tough. There, you get to a point, you know, but some people get a break after 10 years, you know. I don't know, but I got my break after I switched. You know, and it just wasn't, it wasn't me though, but I didn't talk about it online. I do now. I talk about it now, but when I was going through the rebrand, there wasn't like a post that was like, you know, a note from my phone, but it's all sappy. Like, this is my new direction. I just like did it, you know? And so then I talk about it now, you know, I can talk about it now with you guys and tell you guys that it really wasn't me anymore. And it's like, okay. Spotify is really important streaming service. What's the most important streaming service? Spotify, Apple Music. You got to get them all. Just get them all. What do you think about fucking up the genres with Barong? You changed the game hard, brother. I love it, man. Barong is an avenue to do weird shit, you know? Barong was the place that I started releasing music at 200 BPM, but also slower. You know, the only tracks that I have that are below 200 BPM are all in Barong family. And Jim and Nils pushed me to do that. They're like, hey, let's do a 160 track. You always make 200. Like, let's do something different and do a track at 160, you know? And that's good to do, you know, within reason. How can you capitalize on live streaming during this time? You know, you can put donation links. You can use Twitch, build a subscription fan base on Twitch. That's probably a good way to do it. My voice is ASMR. Oh, that's good. How important is it for you to have really big fans supporting you? I mean, it's extremely important. You know, the difference between a successful DJ and a not successful DJ is how many fans they have. Really, ultimately, it's can you sell tickets? You know, and are you giving people a reason to buy a ticket? You know, it's like when you go see somebody live, is it fun? Is it crazy? Do you remember it? And having big fans, people that like stan you, STAN. I think that's really good, you know, cause I have like fan accounts now, you know, like 3 or 4 fan accounts. And I love them so much. It's great. They make art of me and they talk about me and stuff. And I think that that's really, really, really important, you know, and following the TexCore, branding marketing program masterclass will get you there. Okay. I'm not actually 18, but don't tell anybody. Why did I add a Lil? I don't know. I just did. It was my Twitter name. I love you, bro. Who is we? We is my two managers and my agents. But my managers, both who are partners, they have a business partnership. They're the people who help me create content. So they're very dedicated, you know, they're my friends, you know, we grew together and their company grew, through this project and they've been able to sign even better acts now because of what we've done. And having a manager who's like right there with me, like for me, that really works. Or even marketing my music is a good or bad thing. Is starting off young, having not really known anything about building a business, such as getting booked or even marketing my music, or a good or bad thing? It's a great thing, brother. You're young. You got plenty of time to learn, bud. Trust me. I'm not 18. Thank you for the EDC Mexico love and EDC Vegas love. Big fans are important. Yeah, I've seen a couple comments like that. Fuck the haters, man. If you don't have haters, you're not killing it. That's awesome that you started listening to hardcore because of me. That makes me really happy. Yeah, there's a comment. It's made hardcore digestible to the average EDM fan. That's, you know, that's what I wanted to do, you know, because once, if you can make something extreme, a little digestible through the brand and maybe a little bit the music, then people are more inclined to go the next step and start listening to like really hardcore up-tempo DJs like DRS and Cryogenic, for example, or Anger Noiser, you know, really fucking hard shit. And they go, hey, this is cool, you know, and they start taking steps into that direction. Was Fuck Little Texas a successful marketing trip? Absolutely. That's one of the unique keywords and slogans that we decided. It was just because I got a lot of hate. People were like, fuck this dude, stupid cowboys, not real hardcore. And so they're like, yeah, fuck Little Texas. I have plans of making or at least trying to make songs in as many different genres as possible. I'm stretching myself too thin, or do Pegboard nerds have the right idea? I'm a proponent of picking one thing. I was all over the place for a long time, and when I picked one thing, it worked for me. So you can take that with a grain of salt. It's harder to blow up. It's harder to get bigger doing a lot of different genres. Because then it's, what do people associate you with? You know, that's what you got to think about. That it's like, oh, yeah, he's like Moombahtone, but he's also house, but he's also dubstep, but he's also this. It's like, I don't know. That just doesn't feel... There should be like a loose like thing. It's like, yeah, he does like house, but also like kind of faster house, or like he's trap, but he's also dubstep, or, you know, I'm like fucking hard dance, hardcore and hard style, period. End of fucking story. I still know the MOD guys, for anybody out here who's watching from who's followed me for a really long time. Gloria, do you recognize what an influence you have on people? Oh, thank you. I appreciate that. I'm here to provide information. What about demonic babies? It's my son, Pancake. Large hats and long coats are my brand. Yes, they are, brother. Okay, let's see right here. I just feel demotivated a lot of the times that I may not be able to make it big because in India there are not much people who support music as a career. Yeah, that's tough, bud. You know, but you can fight through any adversity, man, if you believe in yourself, like for real, set the goals. The good thing is we have the internet, man. You could be in India and you could literally be insanely huge in America or insanely huge in Germany. You just never know, you know. What are your opinions of record labels? Barong is great at releasing unique tracks, but majority of labels aren't like that. Labels are good. They can help you. But you need to make them come to you. You need to build your own brand, your own organic system and fan base online through your own socials, and the labels will want to come to you, and then you'll be able to, you know, have a better relationship with them and get more done. Out of all EDM music genre, what made you go with hardcore? I just like the fast shit, man. It's hard, it's fast, it's extreme. It's different. It's got a deep tradition, you know. If I was gonna release a physical music product, I would do vinyl. Cause like, why not? It'd be cool. How do you work with Instagram and your posts? Like, how often do you post? How often do you personally promote your page, songs on the gram? When I do have releases, I do promote my music. I'll do a little sponsored thing, but that's about it. And again, you don't need to post every day. Make good content and post every other day. Like, or post every day and watch your shit fuck up. But that's my two cents. It doesn't matter what DAW is. Doesn't matter. TexCore Volume 3. I like Ableton, though. TexCore Volume 3, absolutely. Coming soon. How is your view on that regarding visual aesthetic and visual presence? Your iconic look. I don't really know what that means. How much is this about is being in the right place at the right time? I mean, dude, look, some of this shit is luck. You got to have a little luck, but you can make your own luck, and you can put yourself in situations to strengthen the chance of the luck, You know what I mean? You got to give yourself the best shot at luck. And some of it is just sheer luck, but you got to put yourself in a position. You can't just sit around and do nothing. Let's see here. I got to go soon, so I'm going to answer a couple more of these. I don't give a shit about two crazy fans. DJs who complain about psycho fans can suck my dick. Fuck those people. That's so fucking ridiculous, man. It's like, yo, if somebody's getting weird in your DM and they're like a little too obsessed, you know what I mean? Like, and they might be like doing some kind of scary shit, you know, borderline like creepy, like, you know, kind of stuff. I think female DJs deal with this a lot, like creepy guys, super fans that are like, blah, you know, then just block them, you know what I mean? Like, whatever. But as far as like the mega fan, it's like, dude, like, fuck off. You're complaining about having fans that buy tickets. Oh my God. Don't even fucking get me started on these fucking guys. These fucking guys who pick their fan base, who want like only certain people to like their music. Like, dude, fuck you. Fuck you, man. That is fucked up. That is so fucked up. That pisses me the fuck off when people are like, oh, I don't want these people at my shows. Like, yeah, if they're being fucking assholes, then of course. But if they're just normal good people but they don't want like furries or something. It's like, I don't want furries at my show. It's fucking weird. Like, fuck that. Fuck that shit. Everybody is welcome at the motherfucking TexCore show, okay? What if you don't like promoting yourself? Get over it. How do you deal with depression and anxiety? Personally, it's destroyed my motivation. Really good question. Really good question. I'd love to answer this. Good boy. You know, a healthy lifestyle is really important. I think a lot of people, you know, people are clinically depressed, obviously. But a lot of people can, and I've been here, can make their depression worse. They can, do things that are bad and don't have good coping skills and ultimately like perpetuate, a cycle of depression and anxiety. So for me, staying busy, setting goals, working out, you know, since there's not that many people here, you know, I'm in recovery from drug addiction and alcoholism. So I've got 5 years completely clean and sober. I haven't done a drug or taken a sip of alcohol in 5 years. I go to like, you know, programs, or I you know, I go to certain groups that some of you may know about, to keep myself in check, and to focus on mental health. Therapy is great. You know, if you need meds, and you need to do that, then you need to go get meds if you're clinically depressed. You know what I mean? If you have a brain chemistry issue. But for me, physical health, spiritual health, and, you know, a routine of maintenance on those two things, and having fun and being social and not staying in my room all day long. Those things, which is hard in quarantine, but those things are what, you know, kind of helped me with my depression and anxiety and just working, man. I'm going to do some sound design stuff eventually. Trying to find some more questions here. It's Outlaw. You can buy the baby on Amazon. It's like $30, man. But this one is special. What's my favorite candy? Sour Patch Kids and Mexican candy. Pulparindos, pica fresas. I like the mango suckers too, and the watermelon suckers. Really. Do you think the quality of a brand can carry the quality of an artist's music? It can help, but ultimately the music, people gotta like your music, and people gotta like your DJ sets. You know what I mean? It's like, dude, like, yeah, the brand helps, but people aren't going to like my DJ set because maybe a few, but people aren't going to my DJ set because they're like, oh, he's really funny at memes. I should buy a ticket to his DJ set. Like, no, people come to my show because they want to hear the music. You know, the brand props up that it's an extra layer. Yes, I will be at Masters of Hardcore in September. It's the complete same lineup. How do I balance learning music production, music theory? You just got to work one day at a time, man. You got to just kind of do it all at once. I think that you should, streetwise, is it a good idea to get a manager myself, or should I build a brand and attract one later? I think attracting a manager is better. Always attract. Way better. Okay. Yeah. Again, you know, you want labels and managers and stuff like that to come to you. All right. So look, I gotta go, guys. I ran over a little bit on the time, but I hope this was informative. Again, key points. Here's the key points: music and content. Okay. Be an artist. Be an entertainer. Find out those key indicators for yourself and your brand. We don't have any. A lot of us don't have anything to lose, so there's no like rush. You know what I mean? Like, just come up with something organic. Bring your whole world into your brand. You know, and just be original, man. Just fucking do you. You know, we have one life to live. Why be like somebody else? You know, you know, I want to be like a hardcore DJ, but I want to be my own version of a hardcore DJ. You see what I mean? You know, it's like, yeah, I Anger Fist is God, you know, but I don't want to be Anger Fist. I want to be Lil Texas. I want to play the same shows, but that's it. You know, like, I don't need to make Anger Fist kick drums to do what I do. You know, like, I want to make the best Lil Texas kick drums. I want to get better at making Lil Texas, not get better at this other, you know, shit. So again, go to my Instagram, look up the Artist Manifesto. Okay. Really, if you guys want to understand everything that I'm talking about, that is where you will find it. Again, it looks like you got to scroll pretty far down. It's this. Okay. Also, feel free to slide in my DM on Instagram or wherever. Twitter, not so much. Instagram, slide in my DM. If you have any more questions, I'll help you out there, okay? So this has been really great. I love you guys. I really hope this helped you guys. I really do. And seriously, if you have more questions, you just let me know. Just slide into the old DM and I'll answer you. And thank you to everyone who supported me and all my music and all that stuff, you know, like, for real, I couldn't do this without you guys. Straight up, like, my life is good. And despite the fact that we're in quarantine and all that, life is good, you know, and we're going to get through this. And, you know, again, if you have any more questions, just DM me, tweet at me, whatever. I'll answer all of them. You know, I got nothing to hide here. I just want to help and share my experience and how it worked for me, you know, which might not work for everybody, but I think it's a good thing. All right. Love you guys. Spring Mix tomorrow. Oh, yeah. Let me look shameless. Look, got to do a little shameless promotion. Spring Hardcore Mix tomorrow. Yeah. Tomorrow morning, Spring Hardcore Mix. No, this is really fun. I love this. So hopefully we'll do some more stuff like this. Shout out Barong family. Shout out to the whole team over there. Jim, Nils, love you guys. Daisy, Tice, Andy. If I forgot you, I'm terribly sorry. But we love you. So yeah, bye.